Okay, let's, you all set? Okay. Let's open the planning board meeting for Monday, July 25th, 2016. I'd like to thank HCAM for setting up over here. As you can see, we're not in our normal 211 meeting room. I'd like to thank the school administration for making an air-conditioned library. Certainly, the air conditioner is an awful lot more quieter, and hopefully you can hear us all on the mics on HCAM. We're currently missing two members. We're going to do some other miscellaneous business, and we'll kind of push everything back a few minutes. I know one member is on his way here, and so we'll try to make up that differently. We have two things on the agenda, two continued public hearings. One is for the new elementary building school committee, or for the new building site on Hayden Rowe. And the other is the continued public hearings for Legacy Farms on the north side. And that's the major business. We're going to take a couple of other minor items first, so that we have time for the two members to come here. The first item will be an 81T plan for 151 Hayden Rowe. This is the Todaro House property with Waterfront Farms. As the board members know, we approved that historic structure subdivision at our last meeting. So with that, I would entertain a motion to endorse the 81T plan, which is what was submitted last time.
So moved. Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? And the same motion carried.
Just started.
Okay.
Who wants it?
We need, what, two signatures and a date, so somebody should take care of that while we move along. The Form K for Thayer Heights. Form K is how we release lots from subdivisions. House has been constructed years and years and years and years ago.
Built in 1990.
And basically, some lawyer doing a title search during a sale realized that the lot had not been formally released. So we're kind of making up for something that didn't happen in 99, I guess. So I'd entertain a motion to sign the Form K for the Thayer Heights, and this is what address?
7 Wild.
7 Wild.
So moved.
Second. I hear a second. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstaining? Motion carries.
There's two copies here. If you could sign both, please.
And you need
at least five signatures.
Okay. So we'll keep passing that along as we're signing. The next item, we're still waiting for our member that's expected to be here. Is the peer review. John, Jennifer, and Elaine, we were the subcommittee to read through all the different proposals, and we have selected three firms to maybe interview further.
That's correct.
And go ahead.
Do you want me to say it aloud who the firms are or not yet?
I don't know.
Good to you.
We will be contacting
them. We will be contacting them.
But
we need to decide if we want to hold a special meeting to do interviews, if we want to interview them during the day. Before we contact them, we need to have this information. Who would be interested in interviewing them? Those kinds of things. So I just need some input on that before we can contact them and set up those days. So, anybody have any thoughts? If they're interested, if you're not interested, let me know and we'll take you off the list.
Well, no, let's the two options. One is maybe we have a 6 o'clock meeting, breaking at 7 to 7:30 for a group snack or dinner, and kind of do those two interviews at our next meeting on August 8th. Or we have a completely separate meeting.
That can be during the day.
Tell me what preferences people have, please.
Evening for me.
I can do it.
Yeah, evening for me as well.
I'm an evening person, please.
So, you were saying like 6?
7.
I will not be able to make it for 6. I can be here by 6:30, I think. 6:30 would be about my length.
Excuse me, Chair. Yeah, could you fill me on what that was?
This is meeting up with the peer review for the selecting the peer review folks.
Okay, thank you.
So, am I hearing something for 6:30 and no break for dinner?
Or a different day.
Or a different day. We could put it on say, the Tuesday following, the 9th. Tuesday the 9th at 7?
Tuesday the
9th,
but...
All right. There's a Board of Selectmen meeting. I don't know if that matters. I give it to Jen.
No, it's just for just interview the peer.
Yeah, I was just wondering if I made any comments.
Why does like 7 or 6:30 not work for
what?
Does I don't want to overcommit people that maybe might try further, but 6:30 is what Brian mentioned, and then
I did. I think 6:30 on the 8th is only an hour, and you're going to do 3. I don't know if that gives you enough time to fully vet 3 engineering firms.
What else do we have on the 8th?
Well, I assume you'll be continuing. Right now, you don't have anything else, but
in legacy, most likely.
Most likely.
In that case, we have to. Could we commit to say 6, and then as people get there, they get there? I couldn't get there at 6, but I could get there 6:30-ish and join you guys in progress. Would that not be fair for the first?
I don't know whether it's fair or not. How about the 9th at 7?
It's a Tuesday.
Or make it the Wednesday. Maybe not conflict with the selected.
That's a big deal with the selected. I just mentioned it.
I mean, 211 is open on the 9th, so it wouldn't matter.
Let's do it on the 9th at 7. Or, 7 o'clock.
That works for me.
Sounds good.
Okay. Okay, now we've got everyone here. So let's open the public hearing for the new elementary school at 129 Hayden Rowe Street in the town of Hopkinton. For everyone here, we have an updated outline as we proceeded on last time, so there's a couple more copies over on the table behind us if you don't have it. I would just like to start with a small quick statement on the waiver request. I gave a wrong impression last time that the planning board could grant a lot of the waivers. A lot of the waivers, if they were to be waivers, would be granted more by the ZBA as opposed to us. We have a couple, but Joe wants to take us through where we are on all the items that we talked about, and I think at the end of that, they've made a lot of progress figuring out where we are in some of these. And then we will proceed with, after that, then we'll just go down the outline.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Courtney's advised me to speak a little louder because the mics on the table are the only mics in the room. So thanks for bearing with me on that. I first want to kind of talk about some of the unique elements of this project compared with many of the other projects that come before you. One is the project timeline. We have Compass Project Management managing our timeline for us, and we've committed to the town to open a school in the fall of 2018. If the permitting process takes substantially longer, say into the late fall, winter, we could be jeopardizing our ability to open, to get all the other activities done. We got a huge Gantt chart of dependencies, getting those other activities started on time. And we could be, for pushing out a month or two on the front end, could be looking at a year delay in opening the school. So that's a project consideration and why you might see a little bit of anxiety on us when we start talking about how long some of these permitting things take. But we've been working with your firm and very productive last week, so we're confident we're going to continue to do that and get through as quickly as possible. The budget is also unique in this case. Many of you recall being at town meeting in the fall, where town meeting authorized a specific dollar amount for this project. What that means is that as we've gone through the detailed design phase of this project and we found site costs were higher than anticipated in the schematic phase, we had to take costs out of the building in order to put those into the site. And that will continue to happen. Any requirements that are found on this project from here out, we would then not be adding additional top line to the budget. We would just be moving something from somewhere else in the educational program or other features of the building or site and moving it to that new feature that was not part of what we presented. So that's on the budget. So we have a fixed budget in this case. It's a little different than other applicants, I think. Partnership with MSBA is also unique. This affects us in a few ways. Basically, anything that we want to do, we review with them. And while we're doing it, we tell them we're doing it. And after we do it, we have kind of a post-mortem and review what we did. So it's a very highly monitored and regulated process. And there are certain things that you might consider mitigation for a typical project that would severely complicate things for us with our partner, the School Building Authority. For example, any kind of use of project funds for off-site mitigation would be an extreme complication, for example, whereas it might be fairly routine for other projects. And finally, the Dover Amendment is unique. And as many of you know, the Dover Amendment, and I'm not an attorney, but I did speak with one today, so I know a little. And I think there's a letter in your packet as well. But the Dover Amendment, as you know, is it refers to the Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 30 or 40A, Section 3, and it provides exemptions to basically religious, educational, or agriculture uses from certain zoning restrictions. So, as you see in your packet, we had town council review the project and the waivers we originally came in with, and they've provided their analysis to the board. So with that, I wanted to go through some of the things that you reviewed last time we met, and give kind of an update on, and a little more context on the reason why we're asking for it, and then kind of an update on the status. The building height, there's in the bylaws for this zoning district, Residence B, there's a height limit of 38 feet. Given the 35 feet, sorry. Yeah. Our building height is 38 feet, so it's 3 feet higher. The reason it's 38 feet is in order to have the classroom height that we needed and the space between the ceiling and floor and ceiling and roof on the second floor for the equipment and other infrastructure supporting the school. It ends up at 38 feet. There's not a whole lot we can do about that. So we're asking for that. And in fact, the zoning enforcement officer, we asked for his opinion, and he's provided it, and I believe that's also in your packet. So on the 50-foot landscape buffer, this is a situation where we anticipate during the construction part of the project disturbing some of the buffer, but never beyond the 25 feet, but between 25 and 50, disturbing it during construction, an area of the site that abuts undeveloped property. But we do plan to plant back that 25 to 50 foot area at that location upon completion of the construction of the project. So that's where we are on that one. Again, the town council has advised that requirement is not applicable for the Dover Amendment. But I wanted to give you the full picture on what we plan to do anyway. Parking area landscaping. This is a situation where town and personally me too, I'm sure I supported this, came to town meeting, doesn't want to see a bunch of blacktop and the heat that it causes and the runoff that it causes. We've had lots of civil engineering discussions on the site, given the site issues and the drainage issues. We actually have drainage systems underneath the parking lots, placed under the parking lots. We have had input from Al Rogers, who does the plowing on the site, and for those and a lot of other reasons, we put the green space closer to the far edge of the paved area. But if you look at the entire paved area in the staff parking area in the back, for example, The green area that we put in there actually is around 15%, so it exceeds 10%. If you go to the front of the building and you look at that entire paved area, that would be a paved area, and then you look at where we put the green, we have achieved about 24% of that otherwise paved area is green. So it becomes a matter of where you put the green, not whether we've met the 10% or not. But that's an issue we can discuss, but that's our opinion on it. And if needed, our advice from town council is to write a letter to the zoning enforcement officer to resolve if needed. You asked us to get rid of the net new telephone pole, and we saw it was done under another project. We called, and we've eliminated that. So we discussed that with the utility company, removed the pole. There will be no net new poles. But there are some existing poles that will be moved. Reduce, but we're not going to increase. So we feel we've met your request on that. The rooftop equipment screening, the dumpster screening are two areas that town council has said are not applicable to school project. And let me speak to each of those quickly too, though. This is a site that's completely wooded today and will maintain wooded debris, you know, buffer area around all the edges upon completion of the construction. So it's already highly screened. So unlike other buildings that may be highly visible in the downtown or other parts of town, for example, this building won't be visible from the street. And the rooftop equipment won't be visible from the street or from abutting properties because of the tree and forested buffer around the school site.
Through the chair? No?
Let him finish, too.
So that's where we are on rooftop screening. And again, town council said it's not applicable, but I want to give the full picture on why we were even asking for a waiver when we thought we needed one. On the dumpster screening, we explained a couple weeks ago that the dumpster, given it's situated with a wall around three sides, and so really only one side is visible, and there's some height that makes it even a little more hidden. But we understand that's a requirement, something that's important to the board. Even though it's not applicable to school projects as advised by town council, we're willing to voluntarily screen the dumpster. So we'll do that. The sidewalk along the frontage, we understand there's a larger town project related to sidewalks, and that's why we didn't include that in what we shared with you, because that's a project that may already be being considered or underway with the town. We do have a sidewalk already on the west side of Hayden Row. We have sidewalks throughout the site. So we've been very careful and want to coordinate with the town when that town project does go through on the east side of Hayden Road for the sidewalk. There's a 15-foot light pole height restriction for light poles. As I mentioned, you know, we've had to be creative with managing within the budget. We were looking at is what kind of light spillage we'd get if we had 20-foot poles. As you can imagine, if you have higher poles, you need fewer of them because each one shines a little further. So that would be a way of creatively saving costs on the project. In this case, we understand it would require us to come back with a separate special permit application to the planning board. And we discussed with the project team recently. In fact, the board was somewhat divided, the school building committee, on this topic. But we've decided we'll go ahead with the 15-foot poles, and we can accommodate that within our budget. So, again, we're meeting your requirement on that one. So, I think the final item on the list that doesn't show up on the screen is the secondary emergency egress road, and we want to assure you of any questions you have. We've got sign-off from police and fire related to any questions you have about the 18-foot road width instead of the 20-foot road width. So, that's my quick summary. So, as you see, in the case of Massachusetts school buildings and the Dover Amendment, it actually makes it a little easier for planning boards because there's certain things that just don't apply to the school building project. We do, of course, want to work with you in the spirit of achieving as much as we can, and we've seen a few of the things in there that aren't required, but we're going to do anyway. So, with that, Jeff, I don't know if you wanted to take it to the next phase three, Mr. Chair.
We're ready to go through your agenda. Let's want to recap.
Maybe at this point we'd be better off to save any specific questions because a lot of these issues were also on the outline and we will certainly use what we got, and we'll talk about it more in detail at that point. We are in the detailed discussion part of the outline. Public is welcome to participate in it. This is a public hearing, not a hearing in public. So that means that we welcome discussion. All we ask is use A, your name and address, and wait for the chair to recognize where you're at. Mr. Herr.
Brian Herr, Elizabeth Road. Joe, you mentioned the, so for the dumpster screening, it's not required, but the project's going to go ahead and do that. Correct?
Right.
Is that in line with what the planning board is looking for?
Yeah, a couple weeks ago when we were here, they, there was a point of concern around screening the dumpster.
All right, thank you.
Okay, so let's go on item 5B, which we have is called Relationship to Neighboring Properties and Homes. And I particularly love to hear from the abutters, and particularly direct abutters, because that's the subject is really about you guys. I know we have the across the street abutter is here. I don't see anyone from the open houses or open vacant lots at the back. So anyone, concerns, questions, relationships?
Mr. Chairman, if I may, through you, we have spoken to one abutter whose property is directly across the street from the proposed school driveway, and wanted to let you know we're going to be talking to that abutter between now and the next hearing to see how we can resolve any concerns.
Okay.
Excuse me, is that abutter here tonight?
Yes, right here. Hi. So, should I save all questions until we talk then, or?
Well, let's leave this one open at this point, because quite frankly, we haven't come to a resolution, so we won't check off the buffer aspect and the property at this point, and we'll wait until you have very productive things, but we are on a tight schedule, so I'm hoping in the next 2 weeks you guys are going to come to resolution. Or either that, or maybe we'll decide something if we have to.
But yeah, if we go through the presentation, we'll probably answer a lot of your questions, but if not, we'll certainly follow up with you after this for the next one.
We did a site walk, at least half the board did, and I think it was very obvious to the people that were there at the site walk that there is a concern with the driveway kind of pointing directly at his house. But, okay. Next item is item C, which is input from the Irvine Todaro Committee. Is there Mr. Sonnet?
Eric Sonnet, 60 Teresa Road. I'm a member of the Irvine Todaro Property Advisory Group and also a member of the Upper Charles Trails Committee. We also have Jane Moran here, the chairman of the Trails Committee. The Irvine Todaro Committee is in the process of reaching out to the town via an online survey of what the town would see as uses for this property. The we should have a feel for that by the end of the summer. However, the committee itself has identified some what we consider qualified uses and unqualified uses. From a qualified use, trails and parking for school buses and trailhead parking are let me put it this way. They're key to the whole thing. The trail going through, and you've clearly got to park. The school people have a problem with where to park school buses. We sort of envision those two parking lots being the same bigger parking lot where we could accommodate everyone. The qualified use, we see recreational fields, parks, sports fields, open space, consistent with all the other facilities on the loop road and those type things. Importantly, the disqualified use is residential. Anything more than a standard two-lane road and any use not allowed by zoning. The factors we're considering are school permanence, cost to replace, and future school areas. We don't want to put a big capital structure in place that someday we may need for an additional school. So those things will enter into it. Noise is one of our factors, maintaining rural character, obviously overall community benefit, and cost. So these are the factors we're looking at. From this meeting tonight, I think the most important thing that we can talk about is the trail. We have a commission, a preliminary engineering review by BHP, who's doing the trail through downtown and the downtown project, which is part of the trail that will start here on the Figaro Culver. That part is up in here. That trail could literally go anywhere south of the school on that property. The issue is, how do we get around the school? And if we look at your plan, we see that the school bus road does a bend around the top of the property, top being eastern part of the property, and then goes out through an emergency road to EMC Park. Well, this is our vision for phase one of our Upper Charles Trails committee, or Upper Charles Trail. The issue that we have in reviewing plans is when you go into the buffer zone and take out 25 feet and then replace it later, the grade that you put on the off the side of the road will not facilitate the trail. We would ask you, when you do that, to make that outside of your bus highway graded so that we can put a trail there. You have a steep drop off now. What we would ask is to do it in the same way the Milford Trail is done. I measured the Milford Trail today. The Milford Trail is 12 feet 6 inches. There's a foot or so on either side of that 12.6. So from our standpoint, if you could give us just a graded flat area on the outside of the school bus road, we will develop it as we develop the trail. Of course, if you wanted to pave it for us, we would be more than appreciative. But essentially, if we had 15 feet, we would be in great shape. 15 to 25 that you're going to reconstitute. As you come around that school bus road and go into your emergency access, how you shut it off is important. How do we get bicycles around your gate or whatever you have? And in looking at the Milford Trail, they have sort of a trail around the thing. If we could do something like that there, or whatever you decide on that access, that would be great. The other thing that we don't quite understand is you talked about fencing off the school from safety standards. We don't know how that would interact with our trail. We think that you're talking about in support of the school bus road, but in any event, we don't want a fenced-in area that's going to prohibit easy access and accessibility to the trail. Those things are our major concern and why we're here tonight. We see an enormous opportunity here. The phase one of our chart.
Sorry, I think it would be helpful if you just walked up to the slide and showed us where your trail intends to
run. Sorry, I didn't know you had it up.
Yeah. I think I got the gist of it, but I don't know where it's going to continue. Yep, so you're going to cut across there, yep. Bend down, and then where's it going to go? Right along there?
Wherever you have the access for that future road, right here?
Yep.
We would come in here, and come around this way, up through here, and then out here.
Yep, thank you.
All we need 15 feet of that to do that, you know, level with the road. If you could give us a couple feet of a buffer or something we could do to delineate between the school bus road and the trail, that would be great also. You know, from my standpoint, if you're going to clear 25 feet, break your 25 feet and we'll worry about it later. rather than trying to plan and all that stuff, because you'll still have the, you know, the woods and those things behind that. But by coming this way, my next one, this is north.
Right? Yes.
Right.
Okay, well, we've come up from the south. Literally, we envision parking trailhead to be somewhere behind Waterfresh Farm. We have an access road that's one or two houses up on Hayden Rowe. We would bring it in there, let them park.
They zoomed out, so.
Down here, let them park behind Freshwater Farm. Is that Hayden Rowe there?
On the left, yes.
All right, we have to be down in here somewhere. And we would come up and get into the thing there. Then the trail would go through here into EMC Park, up the EMC Park Road to Hayden Rowe, and then over to the loop road, to down around Hopkins School, all the way around the center trail, down center trail to Main Street, or West Main Street there at Hopkins and Lumber, and then it's already engineered a two-way bicycle path up through town to the town common. So we would have a path that literally would tie together all the school properties, our cultural properties with the cultural center there, our recreational, all the fields of the schools and what have you, tennis courts, basketball courts, bringing around down through a beautiful center trail and then up through the business section of town to the town common. And then our plan is from the town common, and we haven't figured out how to do it yet, to get from the town common to Ashland. So that's our plan from tonight's meeting. Our hope is that, one, you can answer that safety question with what you're going to fence off from the school, and two, give us about 15 or more feet around your...
So we can answer the question with the graphic that's on the agenda.
Sure.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
In terms of the fenced area, the plan would be to, the fencing starts at the face of the building, comes up across this zone, vertical, and then around the property and parcel back through here. This is left open.
So it would be in border of the...
Correct.
Of the
right, the fence is off the backyard.
Well, good, that answers that. That's great.
Well, okay, what about the other question of potentially A? We have a flat landing. Doesn't have to be at the same elevation as the road, obviously.
No.
As long as it's flat.
We'll have to look at that in terms of topography, and we can get back to you in a future meeting. But that's not something we can commit to right now without getting detailed plans up, looking at topography.
From what I'm hearing, I don't remember looking at the... You sloped off down at that point?
Yes. Yeah, it slopes away from the parking lot down to the existing forested area. So to get a level there, you might go beyond that 25 feet you're trying to maintain.
Or possibly a retaining wall.
Right.
Before it.
But what about runoff as well? That should be...
Like I said, we need to need to engineer it before I can commit anything. So you heard the request, and so we'll take it under advisement.
Okay. Can you go back to the other slide that zooms it out a little bit? The planning department had... discussions this, I guess, last week with the person that owns all the unoccupied lots.
To the east?
That goes to the east of them. And they're talking about potentially in that area creating a cul-de-sac that's right about, gives about
down towards
six
the,
lots.
Yeah, down towards the middle?
Yeah, down right,
right there.
Less than that. That where the arrow is right now is pretty much underwater. Or wetlands. So basically, the one urban parcel that kind of sticks out in the middle there, there will be no access to that parcel other than through the town property. So unfortunately, they have a piece of parcel that they have a probably legal access, but they have such a wetland that they couldn't get that. That one has very little value.
Mr. Chair?
Yeah.
That parcel, is that also wet?
A good part of it. I suspect.
I mean,
that way. I don't have wetland delineation on that, and what we do on all the ones to the east of that.
Is that, Chair, is that our land, or is that...
No, that is owned by the descendants of Joe Irvine.
Okay.
So the other Irvine property that's kind of right at the bottom of the screen, that one has access and will have access off of that roadway. So that one probably has some value to it. We also talked as a consideration, because we only allow cul-de-sacs for exceptional circumstances, that the exceptional circumstance might be to give part of the back part of that big triangle that sticks into the...
Mr. Chair, I don't mean to get off topic. While we're talking about the development of another property that's not directly adjacent, with the exception of the northernmost parcel, so I just want to get back. Sure.
The relevance is in the setting up the abutter, the abutting in the buffer area might not be as, besides it's not to the Doberman, but building houses right at that area might not occur.
If I can ask a question, you guys obviously put a lot of effort into this design, and I don't want to tell you how to redesign it. I'm just curious. The trail you have design goes around the bus loop, then down the access road to EMC Park, then comes back out onto Route 85.
Correct.
Had you considered, instead of going that route, and I'll explain why in a minute, coming up the driveway of the school to Route 85, because as I understand it, the center trail begins on Chamberlain Street, which is almost directly across. You're also going to have
That's
light there.
That's not the center trail we're talking about.
There's two to the center trail, is it not?
We're talking about the
lower half.
No, more than that.
But I'm saying if you were to come up the driveway where the buses come in, the main driveway, the light's already there, you wouldn't need a light over at EMC Park, and you could go down Chamberlain Street and pick up the entire center trail versus going all the way around the loop. I'm just trying to help. That way, then it would be relevant to what they're doing because you're going up the driveway where they're coming in anyway.
We sort of looked at that, but our objective is to have as little impact on neighborhoods as possible.
Right.
Going up Chamberlain, which is a very narrow street to begin with, mm-hmm. put a 15-foot bike path right along somebody's front yard, and then run 1,500 to 2,000 people by there on a Saturday. We're trying to stay away from that.
Okay.
So that's why we're...
So you're going around by.
Right.
Okay.
If basically, I may... everything we're going to do is to have as little impact on residential.
Okay. Chair?
Yeah, go ahead,
sir.
Could I suggest that other topics that are questions related to the trail master plan maybe be addressed at that
So just briefly, people can go along Chamberlain if they want, but the idea of the trails is to connect various parts of town to the center, and that's what this is doing, bringing it up. And it's a natural connection and bothering the least amount of neighbors.
I think on this item, we got an action item to investigate whether something can be done, or at least as minimum, created in a way that creates no harm. I mean, they might have to spend some serious money to grade it later if it's undoable.
Chair, I would like to pose just one question on
go ahead
on the trail. Isn't it? I mean, we worry about school systems having incidences and stuff. And the trail being so close to the school kind of gives me a red flag. I'm just concerned about the children and the people that travel the trails and how close a proximity they are to these young children.
When we started this part of the trail, I met with two people,
mm-hmm.
Kathy McLeod, superintendent of schools, and Norman Kamala. They were both enthusiastically supportive. Kathy sees this as a way to tie in the neighborhoods into a way to get to her schools. She sees children walking from neighborhoods getting on this path at various all parts of the town to get to her school campus. We have reached out to the fire department, not the fire department, police department, not formally yet, but to get their input as to what safety concerns they see so that we can combine them in our plan.
May I convey something that I thought about? Excuse me for one second.
Yeah, sure.
Is that if you do put the trail, if that does go through, that be segregated by a fence. And the reason why I say that is because we all know a lot of stuff has happened in schools.
I agree with you, Cliff. I agree with you 100%.
Mr. Chair, we're talking about a separate project, a trail project that is not at this point in the permitting process yet. While we've been trying to coordinate with that project, it's premature. We do have a member of the school committee here, however, from the elementary school building committee.
But I think this is pertinent to that aspect of this, of building the school and having a trail. There was an associated correlation between the trail, people that travel the trail, and the kids at the school. And that is our priority, not just the school being built, but also working together with the other town councils in order to make everything right.
Suggesting is that we have an action item. We have a long list here, so we haven't even passed the fourth bullet of the
agreed.
We only have an hour.
And I want to assure you, what got us to this point is working with those other groups and committees.
All right.
Yeah. Let's talk about item D, track.
So at the last meeting, you asked us to come with a graphical slide showing the bus queuing and how many buses could fit within that zone area. What we're demonstrating here. So the bus queue on the right-hand side, you'll see that there are six buses lined up from the bottom right-hand side on the lower right-hand corner up to the back where it spurs off the EMC, and then another six buses fit after breaking the road there. So a total of 12 buses fit within the queue before getting into the zone.
Looks like seven on the second one. Six and seven.
Yeah.
Thirteen total fit within the zone queue.
Yeah. It's worth noting that that's currently one more than our current bus run load. So we only run 12 buses per load right now.
Okay, so there's only 12 buses that come to the school? Or
at a time. They run two waves.
Two waves, okay.
Carly, but they're proposing 25 buses, I thought.
No, it comes in two waves. So a batch of 25 buses.
So one is 13, right. One is 12. Right. To get to the
so that's why you're showing 13, because you need to.
I'll have room for one more.
Okay. So that kind of gives us a good visual.
Yeah, I agree.
They go together.
Thank you.
Okay.
Item D encompasses eight items you want us to just...
Yeah, why don't you kind of give a presentation on the whole thing and get us up there. I found the traffic study kind of hard to understand, I guess. I don't know how the other members of the board did, but...
Mr. Chair, we do have our traffic engineer with us, so Jeff...
Why don't you kind of explain where we're at?
Sure. We met in the interim since your last meeting with Beta, at a review meeting. Nick Haven is here from Judith Mitch Engineering, and we had a sit-down meeting and passed comments back and forth now. So a lot of the items have been resolved. There are still a few open items in the comment letter that we need to talk about. And I know the chairman has raised some questions about the traffic light as well.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The way we did this project, we did it in two phases. The feasibility of the first release were brought in and did a whole three or four different options for the site. And we also did observations of the school, the existing school, two times, once in December, the other one in January. And then once, and provided pros and cons, and we worked with the architect and the developer, the school system, to come up with the favorable options, which is urban side. So once the urban side was selected, then we did the full traffic study. We did conduct counts at four intersections, the Rowe Street and Hayden Rowe, the two high school intersections, and also Chestnut and Hayden Rowe. We also did an ATR, the automatic counts on Hayden Rowe, where the boxes, where the site is located. We used our numbers from the existing school, since the new school is going to probably have the same or probably a bit less student at the place. And we projected the numbers and we did analysis of the existing future new build and future built one as we do for any other project. We also did the accident studies. So we used Synchro 8 to analyze the intersection, the proposed intersection, the new one, at the elementary school. And we did morning and afternoon drop off and pick up times as our study period. And we came up with basically the intersection itself is going to operate at the level of service A for both AM and PM. However, the numbers of the cars that are coming out, they don't have enough gaps in the morning and in the afternoon to go on into the main line, make the turns. They require, especially in the afternoon where the, since the morning drop-off, it happens to my drop-off, I'm not too worried about that, but the afternoon one, when the parents come in and wait for their children to be released, and then they pick up, it's going to be a rush of parents coming out. So the synchro itself, it does it for a whole hour, and I know that you, some people were concerned about the number of the queue cars that are there, that's the number that single does that. But we went back and after our meeting, the beta, and after the meeting over last time, we went down and we analyzed for that specific 20 minutes that the cars are going to be going out. And this is what we get for the queues coming out. And this is actually for the signalized, we analyzed for signalized intersection. So, unsignalized is going to be actually a little bit worse because they don't have that gap that is required to take a left and right. They need 6.4 seconds in the morning to take a left in the afternoon and 6.2 seconds to take a right. So, there's a couple of options. Signalizing the intersection is just the recommendation from us as an engineering judgment, you know. There's a couple of options you can do over there. One is do nothing. Basically, leave it on as a stop control intersection. It's going to take a while for the parents to get out. Everybody's going to be upset. But it's 20 minutes to half hour, 45 minutes, it's going to die down. The other option is having a police detail over there. But and every day that, and or signalized on unwarranted signalized intersection. Now, it does sort of meet the warrant for the schools, but it doesn't meet all the other warrants. The school warrant that it meets is the lack of the gaps. And I'm not sure how many students are going to be walking there, and I'm not in a position of saying nobody's going to walk or so many are going to be walking. But once we have the intersection set up with a crosswalk, you're going to see some students passing there. So the warrants that UTCD requires a minimum of 20 students crossing. So I assume that at one point that's going to be there. So So as part of the safety and circulation point, I think even though the signal is not warranted, we recommend that signal be installed.
Mr. Chair, through you, please.
Yeah.
You've addressed coming out, which to me is not a big deal. There's plenty of room for cars to back up. What we noticed there is the interruption of the traffic on Hayden Rowe. If you're coming southbound, and there's a very short stacking area there, I can't imagine four buses is gonna block the.
100 feet, you know, and I don't think we have the space to go further out.
But I'm just actually. But just hear me out, though. I mean, what kind of studies have you done about buses turning in southbound?
Are you talking about the turning movement or
timing,
like stacking?
The ability to block off Hayden Rowe and prevent traffic from heading southbound.
I still don't understand the question, I'm sorry.
So right now there's a lot of traffic going southbound on Hayden Rowe, right, beyond the school.
Right.
So when you have this new road in there and there's four school buses backed up, is that going to back up the whole road? And
it may, yes.
Well, we can't have that.
Then we have to widen the and provide the stacking. I do understand as well.
To the part of the heart of the question, I have a couple other questions, but really the heart of the question is would a policeman be a more efficient? Describe what kind of signal you're going to do. Is it going to be north and south going at one time, and then the new driveway goes out as the other signal, or are you going to do north and south, and then off from the east?
It will be fully actuated cameras, actuation on the driveway and northbound and southbound. So
the camera will look and see the condition that you have right there and keep the driveway open for a longer time.
Well, there's a limit. It's the most, we have it as a 75-second cycle. And the driveway time is 25 seconds. Do you follow?
Can you explain that a little further? I'm sorry, the driveway is 25 seconds?
The analysis costs for 25 seconds for the driveway. And
are you saying on for the driveway, 25 seconds?
Right. And then I think it's about 15 seconds for the left turn or 18 seconds for the left turn. And the remaining is going to be north
or
south.
Sure.
See, with the northbound having the maximum.
When I have a policeman out there, which we have right up the road, and he sees a line of buses or parents' cars, and you know, he'll wave them on, and I'm going to say he's a little smarter than the camera system. And you know, I also, one of my other questions is, are you going to have a crosswalk? I'll say either crosswalk guard or a policeman at here, even if the light is here. I mean, if you're going to have kids crossing, I mean, we have a crosswalk person up at Grove Street.
Yeah.
So it's going to be a pedestrian button. So right now we're providing for crosswalk. If the light is installed, we have a ped button.
So basically, light takes place of a crossing guard? John?
So we have a crossing guard at the current center school right now.
Yeah.
Those times, I know there's not a signal there, but I don't. We haven't had any discussions about this, but I don't know why there would be any intention not to just move the crossing guard to the new school. We have a crossing guard at a signal by the middle school to monitor that, even though it's a pedestrian push button. So I can't imagine thinking just for myself, not obviously for the committee. We haven't discussed. I can't imagine why we take that one away.
At the middle school and the high school, people crossing down there. I would hope that they're at that point old enough and smart enough to be able to get across a reasonable busy street. I understand, but I used to be a crossing guard when I was in the sixth and fifth grade too. But you know, for preschool and kindergarten, first grade, even with I'm not sure they could find the light.
Yeah, I can't speak for the whole committee. I'm only one member, but we do have one currently at center. There's no. Never had any discussions about reducing that number, and just as an individual, I would support just moving the crossing guard over. And budget neutral, so I don't know why we would do anything.
Didn't we hear through the chair of the building committee that most of the children would be on the bus or driven by their parents, not necessarily walking, so it's...
Well, through you, Mr. Chair, I mean, if you'd like, I'll take that question. The idea is that, these kids are pre-K, kindergarten, first grade. If they're walking to school, their parents are walking them to school. I'll share some of the mood on the committee when we talked about traffic signalization was safety. Even if parents walking a preschooler, it's a very busy road with cars going, and the speed limit is mostly 25, and some parts 40, and people go 60. So it's dangerous on that road. We had our discussions on traffic in the wake of the death of a Hopkins student who was riding his bike near the schools. So safety was of our paramount concern. And we felt that the signalization would help the efficiency of the intersection. You could make people queue up getting out of the school and just wait, make them wait for a break in the traffic to turn out. You could have a signal that's activated during that time of day and then it's added the rest of the day. You could have a pedestrian activated signal. But we felt that some kind of signal was necessary there to ensure safety. But there, we do anticipate parents that live in nearby neighborhoods would walk their children to school on days when the weather's good.
If through the chair.
Let's try to gather some more information. Just if particularly if we have a school bus parking lot in there, describe how many times the buses come in and out. I mean, they come in and out for this school once.
They come in and out for this school
twice. 25, 12, 13, 12. So basic, this is the last. Is this the last school in the rotation?
Yes.
Let me try to verbalize it. If you're going out, if the school buses are parked on the other part of the property, you're going to have 25 buses go out in the morning to go pick up the high school, and then from the high school they go probably, what, the middle school or?
Pick up high school, middle school, drop off, back out for Hopkins, drop off Hopkins, back out for this school in Elmwood, drop off at those locations.
Okay.
So to answer your question,
and then go back to the park.
If the bus barn was there, it adds one round of net trips, so two trips a day.
Got it.
Would be added if there was a bus barn.
And at the end of the day, you got to come back to you.
I think it might be three trips, though. Do they come back before they go to Hopkins?
No, it's continued.
Once they go out to the high school, it's okay.
So middle and high, then Hopkins, then Elmwood Center.
Mr. Hur?
So just to say hi, Brian Hur, Chair of the Board of Selectmen here in Hopkinton. I would be shocked if the town wouldn't expect a signal to put in as part of this project. I mean, that road, and why go down to Watercrest to get a sandwich in the morning? It is busy as can be. Add to that the buses, the cars, parents,
speed.
I think we really have to sort of figure out the traffic piece over time, but I think for tonight we need to plan on some kind of signal, whether it be a flashing signal 20 hours a day, 4 hours a day, try to, you know, put it in green. But for what you're trying to get through tonight, I think you probably kind of need to move on. Kind of signal is going to have to go into the town business.
Just one comment to you, Mr. Chair. I think, Brian, to your point, in addition to the light, we need the crossing guard to get those buses from blocking off Hayden Rowe.
I mean, in the busy times, you're going to have some kind of signal, and I think some sort of security
or
super big.
But we have that in the budget, right?
It's there today. It's already got it there. It's a wash. It's already at center school. You already got the guard.
The traffic light.
Right, I'm talking about the light itself. The light is an expensive item.
Right.
It's recommended, and it's in the budget. Then we should probably, at least for right now, continue down that path a little bit. I do not see the citizens of Hopkinton changing that entire flow of traffic without a solution.
To Ms. Marty, is that light in the budget for this project?
Yeah, we've been carrying the expense of the full signalization at the intersection as part of the budget.
Thank you.
Yeah. Of this project.
Let's hear from Beta on this. where are you coming down on this recommendation?
Well, certainly, as far as signalization is concerned, I think there's a little more information that needs to be generated relative to lighting and so forth. We understand that. I think there's a few relative to queuing. I think there's a little information that we've mentioned here that we'd like to see in terms of queuing and so forth, just to ensure that the queue lanes are appropriate. It would be important to understand the arrival rate for buses. I'm sure that they're not arriving in a stream of 8 or 9 buses. They're probably fairly well spread over half an hour and so forth. So at least having some sense of that, I think a signal could be designed and could be justified, not necessarily through warranting, but through engineering judgment. So I think you can have a choice in a signal if there's a strong feeling in the town that that should be done. And it will certainly provide control at the intersection, particularly, for example, coming out. When you've got a lot of traffic coming out at the 3 p.m. time frame, getting out left from there could be a problem. Getting out right from there in terms of gaps could be a problem. So I think provided that the cues are thought about properly, the signalization of the intersection could be shown to work. As far as unsignalization, I think that's certainly a discussion that the town could have. Clearly, that's working elsewhere. That could be equally successful here, so there's a choice to be had. So with signalization, that's our feeling there. I think the other thing that the applicant could do well just to describe to the board is the relationship of the peaks. So for example, you in the morning, you probably see a bit more of a clash of the peaks in terms of peak traffic on Hayden Road versus school activity. I believe the school is a little later in the morning, but certainly in the afternoon, the offset of the peaks would be a little more favorable to signal operation. So I think there's some other considerations there relative to how the signal will affect traffic on Hayden Road and so forth.
That beta concept, the school does start at 8:45, or 9 o'clock, sorry, to put that in context. So I know the crush of traffic on 8 relative, or around the high school, middle school start times, which are 7:25, but the start of the new elementary school is designed to be 9 a.m. And it gets out at 3:50.
So what you're saying is that traffic on Hayden Road is going to be bad from before 7 a.m. until 9:15 in the morning?
Yeah, that's correct.
The peak hours are before
9. I think while we have Selectman Herr here, I think he hit the nail on the head as far as people are concerned about how Hayden Road traffic is. And we had a presentation at town meeting a couple of years ago where there were some improvements suggested for the high school area, and the presentation ended up being shot down in flames. But I think, and this is not Joe's committee's responsibility in any way, but I think this corridor is all the way from Chestnut Street to Grove Street is really the next to be really looked at, and whether this piece of it is the highest priority for the town, I don't know. I mean, I guess if we save the money on this one, I'm sure that elementary school building committee would find it very good use to spend the $400,000 on something else for the project, so I guess the town wouldn't put it in their pocket, but it just seems to me that you got to really do it with the thought of improving the next couple big entranceways down the road, or you're kind of wasting some money.
We've had a lot of discussion in recent years about safety in the area of the schools as they exist today. And we had that very unfortunate situation of the death of a student, which further discussion. But with this new school going in and hundreds of kids going down, you know, another mile down the road, yes, that whole discussion has to go all the way down, I think, to the town board. So we have to look at it. I think we will. I just would encourage us to take a look at this light, leave it in the concept, leave it in the plan for now, and we'll figure it out in a coordinated fashion with the DPW and everybody else. You need the police chief here, you need a lot of other folks.
One final question, yeah. Mr. Chairman. I'd love to, as you're doing the analysis, figure out, if you're a working parent, how long is it going to take me to drop off my son or daughter in the morning? And conversely, how long is it going to take me to pick up and get out of the school driveway and back on my way home? Because I heard something in there, a neighborhood 20 minutes or 25 minutes? Maybe I misunderstood it.
No, 20 minutes is basically the peak period that all
traffic is moving on.
All traffic is heavy.
It's a tight point.
Drop off in the morning.
First class. Oh, yeah. First class students. Right. I mean, you are emptying out a building.
I understood.
In the morning, usually the parents are, it's a live drop off. You know, they drive in. In the afternoon, the pickup is a little different because they come in and kind of mingle and play dates and wait for their children before.
I'd like to understand that.
Move it along to a couple other points. So the center school start 9 a.m. There was a question here about the stagger. The middle school, high school start at 7:25 and Hopkins starts at 8:15. So this new school is not a direct overlap with those other schools in terms of that 20, 30 minutes before start line. So there is a stagger between those two. There was a question on the outline.
Of what, about 40 minutes?
45, yeah, 8:15 at Hopkins until 9 a.m. I did want to get to the parking lot discussion, and I'm running shorter on time, and that was it.
Well, you get granted that extra 15 minutes we took you at, so we pushed everyone back, Roy, 15 minutes, because we were short a couple of members at the early part, so we're going to get there. The only key one, that question that I had, that I was the DPW director. And the first one. His concern was the alignment of the bump out going north, and whether or not the bump out was far enough. It almost, he said there's like kind of collision with the left-hand turn lane by a couple of feet.
There's probably a better slide to look at than I saw.
Yeah, this lines up with the other lines, with the other lines over here. So this pushes back, you know, to push the people to the right a little bit, just to go on a north path. Normally what we can do, we can also put like that double yellow broken lines on and just force people to channel lines, go down as well.
Do we want people making a jog in the middle of an intersection?
What is being done is not unconventional. However, we would share DPW director's concerns somewhat, and it can be addressed fairly easily. There's certainly room on the easterly side just to do a little extra widening. The concern on our part is the left-turning vehicles are crouching into the intersection a little bit and encroaching a little bit more into the line that's being described. So by just offsetting them just a little bit more, 2 to 4 feet, I think you'd be able to fix it. But it's not uncommon to have a little transition to an intersection.
Okay. This looks like a good 4 feet plus.
I would say, yeah, I think we'd just like to see it sketched out, but somewhere in the 2 to 4 feet range we should address that.
Okay. We received that comment today. We talked to DPW today. We are going to look at
that. Sorry, Mr. Chair, just for my follow-up.
Chair, Jeffrey, have we received a comment from DPW on that?
Not written. It was a...
Yeah, it would help to have that. I know it's kind of hearsay until we see something in writing.
So just a follow-up question on my question earlier, in the left turn lane heading southbound. Did you say that's 100 feet? It doesn't look like 100 feet.
Yeah, I think it is. It's about 100 feet over here because we can stack up to 5 cars.
How wide is the driveway coming out? That's 20 feet? I'm trying to do a comparison of...
This one?
Yeah, the width of that.
It's got to be 3 lanes.
It's 36 feet.
So that's 36 feet. Doesn't look like 100 feet of turning lane then, if everything's to scale.
I'll find out then.
Okay. And just for the future, when you can find out like how many cars it could hold and how many buses it could hold, that would be very helpful. Thank you.
I'll double check on that.
Okay. Can we kind of... Yes, sir.
Dave, just across the street. So I'm curious, maybe it's in the paper it's been handed out, and I know we're going to talk, but what are you actually proposing for a light? A hanging light in the center, or one of each con?
This is actually a pavement marking plan and signage plan. It's going to be a mast arm and a couple of those.
So, I'm sorry, could you point to where the master arm would be, or?
The other plan, this is the same.
Trying to get a better picture of here.
Because obviously, as an abutter, a crossing guard is much more pleasurable than a light, right?
Absolutely, but remember, the crossing guards cannot operate, cannot direct traffic. It's a liability as well.
So wait, to that comment, at the high school, the guy Paul does direct traffic, the crossing guard.
My understanding is especially deputized to do that, but not normally.
So we might, you might want to consider putting that type of person in the budget versus the one you have now.
They already are.
Excellent. Yeah. So he can direct traffic?
Yes.
Sorry, go ahead. You were saying the crossing guard couldn't drive traffic.
Our crossing guards are deputized special officers. They're able to direct traffic. So, but I don't know that, again, not the full discussion we're going to have here tonight. I'm not sure that fully is the case. Just thinking through that one question.
So I think you were answering this gentleman's question about
this gentleman's question is
the style of the...
Again, the location of where the posts were going to be, or masts, or whatever you were calling it.
Yeah, it's a mass arm that comes down.
You know, like...
I think it's on your side of the... Because the lights would be facing the upcoming traffic, so the post is being positioned on your property.
I think you were saying two posts. Is it two posts or one?
Two posts, I do.
One on each side?
And then they're going to have a camera out on them to read the incoming traffic from north to south and
runway. Can I ask a question about these posts? Where are they on his property in relation to his driveway? Or near his property. They're not on his property, but in relation to his driveway. I don't see his driveway delineated on this plan.
I'm trying to get to that point.
So you have a sidewalk on that side, right? So the pool will go between the sidewalk and the street. Do you have a sidewalk? Yeah, you
have. Yeah, there is a sidewalk. Yeah.
But there's a spot for a post,
right?
Right
on the curb.
Oh, the sidewalk's right on the curb?
Right on the curb.
Yeah, it's right on the curb.
But I think that his property line is about 5 feet away from the back of the existing sidewalk. I could find one property pin down at the corner of Chamberlain. Assuming that all those lots line up, I suspect there is some room.
So maybe they could just get back to us on the location
of
both.
I think at this point we've asked a lot of questions. I don't think we've come to the final deliberation decision on this subject, but I think we've got everything that we're thinking about out there.
Yeah, I think
that's progress.
We can answer on the location of the poles, the length of the left turning lane, and the lining up of the intersection. I think there's like three or four questions out there, right?
Yep. Okay, let's go to the parking lot.
Hey, I'm sorry, could I just add one to that?
Sure.
What happens during non-school time with this light? Does it just go permanently green, or?
The timing could be changed right now. It's set off to turn off at 11 at night until 6 in the morning. Those times could be adjusted to be something different.
So what does that mean, it being off? There's no light visible at all?
It's going to be flashing. Flash is going to go on flash.
Just like the one that's tenths of a mile down the road.
Right. The one at Chestnut.
So that would be flashing all night long. Yeah. Okay.
I guess, Mr. Chair, Jeff, is the discussion of how the light is used something that happens afterwards, and we're talking about the infrastructure of the light? Or are the rules around when you put up a light, it has to be flashing? Or it comes out of hand, you want
to
get back.
No, it doesn't have to be flashing. It just, there's no need for it after the hours.
But nothing will happen because it's...
They kind of clock it.
Well, we want to do things in a way that is least disruptive to abutters, so if there's not a need for traffic light, we prefer not to have it flashing.
Well, the question that I think he's asking, if I may, through the chair, is that if the light is flashing, I mean, after school hours, the light can be shut down. And he wouldn't have to deal with that.
I was posing that as a question because I don't know.
But I'm saying we understand as an abutter, he's got an issue. So we need to address that as well.
Yeah, I think you're saying the same thing I did. Yep.
You could also do some shielding on his side with the light so it doesn't flash that direction, I would think.
They're going to have some sort of a regulation for that
might help David get out. I'm not sure.
Again, without a location,
Let's put a driveway on the map, so or anyone any other driveway. It's a mess.
I don't think I've ever seen that.
Okay.
And I know we're going to talk.
No. This is the hearing. The reason I let me explain, David. The reason I spoke earlier is because you weren't. So I wanted to speak on your behalf without mentioning who you were, because it didn't seem like you wanted to bring it up. But now that you are, that's perfectly in order.
Okay,
thank
great.
You.
Yeah. And again, I'm not sure, having talked to my neighbors, I'm not sure anyone realized this might be potentially flashing all the time either. So I know they're not here to speak, but that was not the impression.
Sorry, just one final note. You could always leave a trip light, too, and leave that green running through so nothing's flashing, right? That's an option. That's less inhibited on you, just have a green light.
If you want a green glow all night?
It's your opinion, but I would think that's better than flashing yellow.
Sure, it's better than flashing yellow. I agree. But to still have a glow in your front all night would not be preferable.
I'd like to... Let's kind of move on. I know. I think I need... This is pertinent. Or Jermaine. How is he going to get out of his yacht?
That's why we need to mark the driveway.
Yeah, but I'm, but the question is,
if I remember right, his driveway is
his driveway is just off the other side of the intersection. It doesn't line up directly.
Not right on it.
Right,
just north.
Just north, north of the crosswalk area.
Yeah. We've staked it out, and I can show you what those stakes are.
I was going to say, I don't know what those stakes represent.
Yeah, I can draw your plan and give you options.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Okay. Let's go on to the parking lot now.
So I think we'll have Warner Larson talk to this, David Warner. As I mentioned, we looked at this as kind of an issue around minimizing the paved surface and softening with landscaping. And so we've introduced landscaping that is consistent with our drainage needs and input we received from the flow through the plowing of the school sidewalk parking lots. And David kind of walked you through where the green space is and why it's there. But you see it's within what would otherwise be a large paved parking lot.
Good evening. That's my name is David Warner. I'm the police on the park school side.
First, I'll start with the staff parking lot, which is out back inside the bus loop. What we're looking at is, in terms of the calculation, the way we talked about interpreting this when we met with Beta, was our first calculation is actually going all the way out to the outer pavement perimeter, just looking at the green that you see inside of the perimeter of the pavement, including the parking lot and the driveway circulation, as being considered the definition within which we would do the calculation for interior landscaping. And as Joe mentioned earlier, that is comes out a little over 15% of that total pavement area of the landscape spaces that you see here. And a couple of the reasons why we did that is from our experience over many years and observations, trees tend to thrive in larger soil volumes, and they'll grow more quickly and more effective at shading over shorter periods of time than in islands within pavement. So, I mean, these are more substantial than what we would otherwise put it in the middle. But even if we were to say put that amount of landscaping in here, that area that we're talking about defining that would remain essentially the same. We're just pushing this green over here as a result. We have subsurface infiltration systems under here as well as under this parking lot. And we met with facilities and talked about the need larger landscape spaces for snow storage. We think that this plan is well received with regard to the people who are going to be taking care of this facility. So, then, no, can we zoom down on this one? There we go. I think this is helpful here. And that actually is kind of a conservative interpretation. I think when you go all the way out to this outer perimeter and down here, because that's such a big, you know, just to follow the same logic as basically going to this outer edge and then going to this outer edge out to here, the interior landscape space here was coming out around 24%. That's how we did that calculation for the numbers that Joe explained. In our meeting with Beta, they were suggesting, you know, the possibility of just, you know, going to this edge right here, and then maybe taking a similar amount of landscape over here and offsetting that. And in doing that, that brings the number down to about 12%. So we're still over the 10%. And I think that we have to take into consideration the long-term maintenance and upkeep and balance that with the needs or the objectives of this requirement in the bylaw.
David, if I may ask you, the chair, has anybody done any research about trees next to the asphalt and what the root system will do to the parking lot base?
Well, we have a lot of, I mean, I've been working, our firm has been working with DRA for over 30 years. I've been working with them for 19 years and doing this. So we know what tree species to use that are going to be least disruptive to pavement surfaces. You know, I think that it comes a lot down to the tree species and the setback that they have, that you have to the edge, as well as the distance from groundwater. If you have higher groundwater, then you have shallower roots. Because of the drainage design in this project needing to be separate from groundwater by, I think it's over 2 feet, we know we have good separation from groundwater.
To that end, is that a porous pavement or is it a solid pavement?
It's impervious.
It's impervious.
Solid pavement, yes.
All right. So back to the original question: is that it all wanes upon the type of tree that you're going to be installing there? Is that it? Because I look at it as 10 years down the road, when that tree grows, and the asphalt lifts, and we need a new parking lot, that's expensive.
So there are some species like willows and you know, trees that basically seek out moisture, and they have large roots that will do a lot of damage to pavement. There are other trees. We have a whole selection of trees to choose from. A lot of them are indigenous native species, like maple trees that are not going to be as disruptive. If you have them along the sidewalk and it's a foot away from concrete pavement, you will have even. But if we're having them set back 8 to 10 feet from the edge of pavement, the larger roots will basically have plenty of room to migrate without doing long-term damage to pavement areas.
Comment?
Yeah.
On a sidewalk, I walked through it, and yeah, it's right by where the driveway is, and then up in the middle, all dry, and you can see some of the boreholes that are over there left over, and they look dry, and it matches what they're showing here. So I'm assuming that for the driveway, it's going to fit, and it should be fine. And for the play area, it's going to be a little bit wet in the corner, but should be fine.
Well, again, back to my point is that roots will grow towards the water. They seek out the water, and if there's no water, they go to surface water.
Well, as it is now, there are trees where it's dry, and then where it's wet is this the lower.
I believe in your submittal, there's a landscaping plan with tree species identified somewhere that we've gotten.
Yes, and there were some comments in Beta's letter that we are going to be submitting a revised planting plan to be able to address the comments they have with regard to species.
Okay.
So we'll be seeing that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. We want to finish up in the next 5 minutes, so I want to make sure we get all the questions on the subject there. On the, to the right of the staff parking in the interior area, there's no trees off on the right? Kind of right there? Yeah.
There are, if you look at the hard copy plan okay. that was submitted.
Okay.
And that is a an older part of the rendering that we are updating.
Okay.
There used to be a certain drainage feature there that was moved underground.
Mr. Chair, maybe somebody can educate me about the 10%, because when I look at a parking lot, you can have a huge parking lot and you could say the 500 feet around it are the landscaping, but that allows you to have a huge parking lot. to me, it seems like there should be a little bit more greenery inside the parking lot themselves here. We know it's more expensive to snow plow, but that's a requirement we have for everybody in the town. So I don't know the calculation of the 10%, how that works.
How is Beta feeling about, we gave you kind of an action item last time, is to figure out if something we can be comfortable with having approved it for this applicant, who's kind of one of our own, versus next time they build something like a Price Chopper, which was built before this interior bylaw was adopted.
Let me just point a couple of bullets. So as we talked about, and I'm saying this as an example, I think, you know, as you look at this corner in general, there's a lot of confinement up in here. You know, we're pushing on the buffer for earlier discussions that's talked about a potential trail up in this corner. We want to make sure there's as much planting and so forth up in this area just to sort of create buffer and green space. So if we were to introduce something in here, let's say the same guy is 10 feet wide. So what would happen is you would push this way potentially, because you really aren't pushed that way, we're not moving the entire boat. So to create 10 in here, you might take 10 out of here. So looking at the site sort of in general, as we add some green space, we might take some away. So our feeling was there was a sort of a net zero in terms of selection of green space, just because of confinement. That's the way.
There's another option, is to have less parking spots.
Well, I think certainly down in here, and we didn't talk about it today, but I think an important discussion for the board is the operation of this parking lot, because certainly during pickup, you're going to need a good amount of spaces here to actually allow for people to collect their students and bring them back to the car and so forth. There's an important consideration in terms of overall volume of space and the number of spaces for the PM pickup. The other thing, the thought that we had in this area, just as again as an alternative, not a green space alternative, but I think again this is to this discussion of how this parking lot works in terms of pick up and drop off. But does it make sense, for example, perhaps to introduce a walking area in between here instead of a green space, just to allow some passage from this space to these main collection points? So the net effect of that would be put in this place. So again, you have increase here, decrease there within the parking lot in general. Is there a little bit of a benefit to having more here, perhaps more shade and so forth? But is it, in terms of say, a safety benefit for having another feature there and losing a little green space, or just keeping the green space as it is? We didn't see a huge benefit to introducing trees in here and have questions of survival and so on and so forth. So,
I believe they have a subsurface infiltration. Isn't that in that area?
All in this right. area here, and up in this area here. So we learned, I mean, it's always good to have grid space. We felt that the site in general was pretty well landscaped.
Just one more follow-up. Did you guys entertain the idea of a third parking lot in your future access area?
I'll focus on parking.
Did somebody else mention that as well? As
on the trail?
Other parking, no. Future access area. I mean,
the Todaro lot is different, and it's for future bus parking.
Yeah, I mean, we don't know. We can't vouch for the time frame of that.
There's no other spot to put a third parking lot.
Right. That's fine. That's outside okay. project scope, but something to the town to consider.
Okay, I think the witching hour has arrived. I think we have several action items to go so far. I think we had some good discussions today. Certainly, if their board members have other questions, you can email them to Jennifer and she'll get them out sooner if you have a lot of other issues.
It's not a specific item because that one has a waiver associated with it.
Okay, let's...
Well, that, I believe it's the zoning enforcement officer's determination at the board.
So I think our question through the chair is, you know, given that if the board doesn't like what was presented, we would then want to present a letter to the zoning enforcement officer requesting an evaluation. So I think Jeff, is that your question about the timing?
Yes.
How are people feeling about proving it as is or requiring some more green in the interior?
You want to take a vote on that?
To determine whether or not they meet the zoning requirement.
I know we are
providing 10% in the interior of the parking lot. That's the zoning requirement.
It gets down to the definition of what is.
We'll make that interpretation.
Who can answer that question?
Zoning.
Zoning officer.
It should go there.
I mean, I don't think, based on town council letter, I don't think the court has any jurisdiction.
Right.
Well, I thought it was...
I mean, I know you're arguing that you meet the requirement.
We believe we do.
But I still think it should go to the zoning enforcement officer for his determination piece, that he would decide whether or not you meet the zoning.
That's fine. I mean, you want to... As I mentioned in the opening pitch, Mr. Chairman, we are open to doing that. We wanted to bring it up here because this board does have authority to agree or not. But if you don't, then
It's not that we don't agree. It's that we're kind of perplexed as to what, how it is to be,
how other people should
interpret it.
We just don't know if we're voting for a variance or not.
So
we don't know if it meets the standard or we're voting for a variance.
So you're looking for the zoning?
Yeah.
To go ahead and vote on it.
Maybe Beta can write a letter on how they're viewing it also, which I think was supportive. And then we'll present that to Chuck over the next week or so and try to get his opinion on it.
Point of discussion, if I may. I would like to see a green strip in the middle of the lower parking lot. If that means it's just a matter of switching one side or another and it's the same percentage, the part that, what's your view of the percentages? And I haven't heard that answer. So your report to us is...
I would second that too. Is that
incomplete? I don't have all the information.
I think what I heard was that the applicant feels that they meet the 10% for sure. Beta could figure out a way that they kind of come up with those kind of similar numbers.
Prove to the zoning enforcement officer how they need it. They don't work for us, not the applicant. Right. I don't think that's Beta's job, but I want them to be analyzing it, particularly. They don't have to because it's going to come back from the zoning enforcement whether it's okay or not. We'll write a letter to the zoning enforcement with our justification. It's on us to prove our point. That would be helpful.
But I mean, another point before we close for today, I understand your time limit on your lighting with your reducing of the pole height. You know, we could approve something as a 15-footer and then also take your time. That gets you going, and then you come back to change that parking lot as an amendment to your 20-foot poles.
I thought you guys didn't need a variance on that. I thought you were all set.
They were going to go 15.
Yeah, they were. But, you know, I've also heard the cost consideration, et cetera.
Thanks. We'll consider that.
Okay. Entertain a motion to continue this to August 8th at 7:45.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. So the discussion, seeing none, how you vote.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, aye.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you, guys. Thank you. Appreciate it. You're putting in a lot of work. Okay. Oh, Joe. Yes, sir. Are we going to get this place next time? Yes, this worked out. I think we're going to do this again. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Yes. Okay.
I'd like to open the continued public hearing for Northeast, Northwest, and North Club Villages at Legacy Farms. This is for the Osgood site plan review. We'll take up the master plan special permits maybe later.
Before they have to be removed.
I don't see anyone. Mr.
Chairman, do you want to know what's going on with this?
Sure.
You brought a guest.
Hi. We are to the point where we want to close this about 9:55-ish or so, and then we've got just a few minutes of stuff afterwards to take care of. We, tonight, I did already open a public hearing for the site plan review. Tonight, we have several special guests and this is the long-awaited and much-studied discussion on site safety, and particularly in regards to the liquefied natural gas facility that abuts the property. And Roy, why don't you start with your mitigation proposal?
Sure. Okay, Roy McDowell from Legacy Farms. Just to give a little history, this conversation has been going on a little over a year. Relative to any potential safety concerns or mitigation potential measures for development on the north side of Legacy. Numerous consultants have been engaged on the part of the town and the part of Legacy Farms ourselves. We had Iowa Mosaic do multiple reports. They were first done a little over a year ago. The town then had some reports done, and we had those reports critiqued by Iowa Mosaic. We had another firm do some reports also. And then the town, again, then hired Mr. Zemba, Steve Zemba here from Sanborn Head, who again critiqued further reports. So there's been numerous reports done, numerous critiques, if you will. And the most recent version that has been looked at is a mitigation aspect to our development in the safety aspects of the LNG facility is putting in sort of a perimeter, if you will, of gas lanterns. And the concept of the gas lanterns is, and was designed by a Mosaic, that if for whatever reason, if there were a catastrophic failure of the tanks and there was a massive release, and there was a vapor cloud coming in that direction, if in fact it were to penetrate beyond the property of the LNG facility, which is unlikely, highly unlikely, but if it did for whatever reason, these lanterns would immediately ignite that vapor and it would immediately trace itself back to the source, therefore keeping it contained within the property. There's been numerous conversations just even over the last few days between Steve Zember and George Melhelm from Iowa Mosaic about strategically reallocating some of these fixtures, and it was Mr. Zember's recommendation, and that's the most recent plan as of earlier today. It's taken the lights on the north side of the site closest to Rafferty Road and moving them slightly further back away from the facility, giving it an opportunity if there were a relatively small spill or release, if you will, not to immediately have something ignited, but to give it the opportunity to dissipate itself. So we've, in conjunction with Mr. Zemba, redesigned the layout of the lights, and if the board is in agreement with this, we're in agreement with this current layout, we feel that our consultants have said the same.
Okay. I'm going to refer to this plan that everyone got tonight, I think.
Yeah, it was on your table tonight. Not the one in your package.
Thank you, Jennifer.
This is kind of the culmination of lots of study and lots of work that people have done. I'd like to talk a little bit about what you're seeing on there. You're seeing some very large circles showing in kind of a pink and an orange. Those are the limits of the thermal exclusion zone, which is defined where basically you get burnt to the point where... Steve, define that better.
You basically get burnt in a fatal way. So you could, at that orange line, survive a certain degree of exposure, take cover, and you'd be okay.
You'd have to do something fairly quick, like get in a car or get in a house.
You wouldn't have much time at all closer.
Yeah. And then we saw from the town, we had the selectmen's reports that got a lot of press, which, in my opinion and Steve's opinion, were not properly fully done, but they illustrated there is a concern, but probably not anywhere to the magnitude that was depicted by that particular study. Significantly less than what people in the industry kind of feel is something for this magnitude. So we kind of started off with a huge cloud, but something realistically, and I refer to the former fire chief's testimony that was, I think, in your packet for the DPU, where he had said that he had heard from Eversource or NSTAR at the time that 3,700 feet was the vapor area. 3,700 feet would take it into some of the Pulte development, for sure. So that's kind of why Roy has come up with this
study,
ignition aspect of it.
For the
And I guess my feeling is kind of once it gets off Eversource property, their problem becomes our problem. They've already not been able to solve it. Now, most of that north side was granted as an open space area, and Eversource has a restriction, I guess is the right word. Or
they actually piggyback the town's rights.
Right. So basically, they've kind of bought into the north side as additional buffer space. But maybe Steve can explain it. If the gas is coming and it's moving at, I forget how many meters a second or a minute, the cloud is moving downhill from that. It moves pretty fast, and I can't remember the numbers. We talked about them a week or so ago.
But isn't it an uphill transition?
No,
that's
down
the direction.
Going up towards Legacy North.
No,
it's an uphill situation.
The plant is basically at the crest of most of the hill. I mean, it goes a little bit over the...
the transfer.
You're coming down most of that. And the highest point is kind of probably at the edge of that, on James Sullivan.
Okay.
But the gas cloud, if the wind is up such, it's moving with the speed of the wind, basically.
Well, a little faster. It can be a gravity flow. It's a little bit air, cold.
Right.
It can actually move a little faster.
Doesn't heat attract cold?
The cold in this case is just cold vapor. I don't think it's going to attract it, but it's going to affect it. Because once you transfer into it, it's
going to
break it up.
Thinner and more
expands.
Buoyant.
Right.
So the question again is, does Chief, if I may, does heat attract cold?
I would actually think you're talking to the right guy. He's the PhD in the topic.
So can I have an answer to that question?
I could try. The atmosphere is going to be the atmosphere, just like it is out there. If it had some cold flowing towards it, it's not going to really attract it. It's going to stay on the ground because cold air stays under warm air.
Right.
So it's going to displace that warm air. It's actually the warm air being a bit of a barrier. It's just push it out of the way. It's not an attraction, but it's not much of a barrier. It's going to be.
It'll still infiltrate it.
But yes. to be clear, it's natural gas is heavier than oxygen air.
Only for a period of time.
The room temperature is lighter. It's right away to 16.
But when it's coming out, it's very cold.
But this is at minus 280 something Fahrenheit. Yeah. So at that temperature, gas is compressed. And
right.
You have to be in a peak to expand it to get it to be true. That's kind of the goal of passive dispersion.
Well, thank you for that. So, I'm opening it up to boards and public members of questions and comments. And,
I like the mitigation. I think it looks good. Everybody came, did a lot of hard work to get to it. Just one comment I would make. I don't even know if it's feasible, but it seems like it's the responsibility of LNG. I would like to see that their property have all these on them and them being responsible for it. For one. I know, I'm just saying, in my opinion, you know. I think Roy could probably get a good place for the land.
We've had conversations with them, and they don't really acknowledge that they have any risk at all. So to ask them to do something where they don't even acknowledge they have a risk is frankly be a futile effort.
I think it would be
nice if they contribute the gas.
As a trade-off.
Through the chair, I do appreciate Roy's efforts on this, and I also think that the gas company should be doing more to mitigate the situation, and we should work with them as a town, through the state, through the federal government, to help mitigate our concerns. And I don't know how we approach them. It's the Board of Selectmen's ball. Safety is one of their concerns. So I'm not sure what our role is other than to root for a good solution, and this is a partial solution.
Hear that a little bit further, Brian.
Just very, very quick and very simple, Mr. Zemba, Dr. Zemba. Are you okay with this plan?
Yes, I am.
As okay as you can be.
And you understand what you're trying to do, and that is you have this big catastrophic release that is very, very unlikely. It's less than the probability of earthquakes and all. But if that happened, and whatever source said is true, or even what the review commission said is true, this is a mergers report, you could get a vapor going a long way. So if it didn't get ignited, chances of not getting ignited are pretty
good.
No, pretty small.
Pretty small.
I mean, it's almost certainly going to spark at the plant,
start a car,
start that fire anyways. But if it didn't happen, you wouldn't want the vapor cloud to trick him to go 3,000 feet or 3,700 meters, whatever it might be, go into the neighborhood and then ignite, because then you had a flash fire in the neighborhood. So if it's inevitable that you're going to have that type of fire anyways, you'd like to start a little bit earlier. When we went through a couple of rounds of comments, last minute type stuff, I got a little concerned that some of the original purposes were a little too close. Because we had a smaller release of methane. Modeling is for LNG. Our modeling is not perfect. I mean, I'd like to say I know exactly what I'm doing, but not always. There's some uncertainty in any type of model. So I was a little concerned that if a couple of those were very close, it was a small release, but it's not going to lead to something that's catastrophic because it's never going to make the neighborhood for practical reasons. You don't really want to set that one on fire. You want to give it a chance to dissipate naturally. And so that's why we moved these back a little bit. So this is kind of a trade-off. What you're trying to do, protect against that big disastrous release, but allow passive dispersion to do what it can do otherwise.
The previous iteration that I think you might have seen in your email had him going down Rafferty Road, which is obviously very close to the tank area, and that was his major concern. So, and in all fairness to Eversource, they have bought the land on the north side of Rafferty Road, so they did create a buffer. We may have made with Rafferty Road becoming Legacy North, having a lot of volume on it, we may have created a almost more sure nutrient source than they might have thought of 40 years ago when there was a sleepy road where probably nobody went there unless...
2 cars a day.
Unless they were going over to the state park, I guess, to find a place to park. But
this risk exists regardless of what Roy was doing anyway, correct?
There is a risk, and quite frankly, there's a lot less risk to people on the eastern part of the town, which kind of goes back to Frank's discussion, in that the cloud will not go further on this, on the eastern border of this particular...
Right, because of what Roy's done, so I prefer that. Right?
Yes, may I? Yeah. It is a very good thing that what you're doing. And again, Doctor, I totally agree with you. Dissipation would be the first source of letting it, you know, while they're trying to get it under control. But under that pretense, if there is a catastrophic release, they're going to want to leave the facility anyway.
They may not have the chance at that point.
Right.
Yeah. Catastrophic release. We really want to take care of it. Someone said it earlier. Really, if you can get every source to the table, the best mitigation measures you can do for catastrophic release on the property, the measures, the engineering measures. And they do that already, to a large extent.
Yes, but like Roy said...
They can always do more. Right,
right. But like Roy said, they're not very open to talking.
There are a couple things that are coming up in the DPU process that the should get involved with their expansion stuff, and that ought to be a good part of the town's discussion.
If I may pose a question to the chair.
Yep.
The chair, for reference, is an ex-engineer or an engineer. Sorry if I made that small. Under your assumption that if there were a catastrophic situation, we have a bylaw that says that we can't ask them to do anything because of the town, because they've already been grandfathered in.
No, they're grandfathered in at federal level, not us. They got waivers from us 40 years ago to build the facility.
Right, but if there was a change, I read somewhere that if there was a change in
if they change the component of the liquefier and move it from one side of the street to the other, most likely that would require them to go through the site part of the approval process. And at that point, we as citizens have
open dialogue.
We have dialogue with a group that has not necessarily been too supportive to surrounding communities, say, in the past.
Right.
I mean,
but times are changing, and I think that they should be privy to that understanding of change.
They might be. Right. That's something we can't control or expect. There's two other things that I thought Frank's question kind of was starting to lead us into from a town standpoint. I'm only going to digress because it's not really Roy's problem, but there is, to the west and the south, we are still relatively not as protected as we could. And unfortunately, Selectman Hurd is no longer here, but, you know, this idea works fine. And it might be for the Selectman to consider whether gas lights might be a preferred illumination far enough away that, you know, because you do have a lot of vacant land, but before you get into town, or, you know, you've got Wilson Street kind of protected by this, by the street.
It's like about 50%, half the circle.
Sure, but, you know, I'm looking at
houses I agree.
To the west, and I'm looking at, you know,
people should have some gas lights downtown, right?
You know, maybe not downtown, but
like Trevor Street,
you know, 200 or 300 feet north of stuff. That, you know, like, for example, the snow dump. the town owns the land down the hill with Snowdon. Maybe we need a couple down in that area, or maybe working with the developer that owns the land from the Snowdon to Wilson Street. I mean, I think, a very novel.
I actually would be comfortable with them putting it on their property for the rest of it.
I would be real comfortable for that, and that might be a discussion that takes place during these DPU type hearings, particularly when they, but they're trying to buy enough land for the liquor buyer circles to meet those. And they don't have to worry about the tanks at that point. And there's lots of things they could do, like put insulated concrete in the bed around the tanks that slows down the evaporation.
So you had 2 points? Or
what?
You had a second point as well?
Second point is that other study identified a accident potential right along Wilson Street with barrier. And I might have shared it with this committee in the past. I don't think that's Roy's responsibility to fix that. But I, again, suggest that maybe we write a letter to the selectmen once we've come to conclusion on this that, we'd be happy to put more of a stone wall or any kind of barriers along that area, something to help protect that area, just because we've identified it as a safety problem, and if you identify something or then don't do anything, I think that's critical.
I would support that letter to the selectmen.
So moved. Second. I think we should do it.
Okay, we'll put a draft letter for our next meeting.
Maybe a follow-up to that, and it's not related to this at all, but I don't feel comfortable with, all the terrorism these days, that somebody can't get on that property and with malintent.
I think that's what we've all been wondering.
Right. I mean, you were talking about an accident, like an earthquake or something. That's less probable than what we see in the U.S. these days.
Well, if I may expand on that, Florida just had an earthquake, didn't they? Seismology just said that they had a 4-point something earthquake off the coast of Florida.
Yeah,
so
we're overdue for the earthquake in this
right.
Country.
Absolutely.
I mean, it's 1630s or something like that. We had a major earthquake. It knocked every off of Cape Ann. And I worked on a little bit on the Seabrook power plant, and they redesigned all the piping once they figured out what the earthquake zones were.
Fortunately, we're outside the Ring of Fire of the Pacific.
I know.
That's
400 years ago. So I don't know if we maybe overdue.
I have 2 questions, please.
Yeah, go ahead.
One is for our professor. So before we heard it, it's possible but not probable. Is that still the case?
For what?
For any cataclysm.
We talk about 1 in a million as being sort of at risk level that we start. It's still very, very unlikely. 1 in 10,000 is pretty unlikely. 1 in 100,000 less likely. 1 in a million is kind of what we call the de minimis.
Okay.
That it's just not worth losing sleep over.
Sure.
And this is from natural events.
Correct.
The statistics. But yeah, the cataclysm of failure is less than that one. I think it's 3 in 10 or something like that.
Oh, thanks. And my second question is for the chief. I don't know if you've seen your specific thoughts about the lighting plan.
I've just been listening to the theory of the PhD here, and it's I think my only hesitation wasn't that their resolution to the smaller incident, that we don't make something worse than the smaller incident. So we spent a lot of time over the last week kicking that around, and I think as long as we kind of constantly evaluate that information in smaller incidents and we don't have a negative impact on the smaller incident, then you're on the right track.
Thank you.
The only area that Steve's one more question. If do we need one more light down Wilson Street? I'm just thinking if the wind is coming here, and Roy's building on this second right in here, is one more light something that might be
On their property? On G property?
No, it would be on this property.
It's probably...
Either that or bring it a little bit further down, you know, take that last one and move it down the road another couple hundred feet.
Further north?
We can do that, make that radius still work.
Yeah, I mean, I would support that. It's still got enough of a buffer that it's going to protect it. And it might catch a little more, right?
So maybe you take the last 280, 270s and stretch them down a little bit. I suspect you're going to be building real close to that orange line. You know, give it a little bit of...
Yeah.
You know, maybe it's not an awful lot, but it might help.
Question, Mr. Chairman. This is just our discussion tonight. We're not looking to vote.
We may be doing some voting on this.
Okay. Just wanted to know the procedure.
So, Ken, if you may, can you tell me what you mean by moving the light?
This last one or two here, move it, I'll say, closer to Ashland.
Okay.
Further north.
Yeah. Oh, I see, yeah. Outward, away from...
Towards the circle.
Away from Rafferty, right?
Away from Rafferty, yes. You know, it'll probably bring the radiuses on those last couple up a little bit more.
Yeah.
But not significantly. And then, it kind of, if there's a direct line from here to here, it's pretty well.
Is that Roy's rendition that you're looking at now?
Yeah.
Can I?
Sure. And also, that last one might protect Kruger Road a little bit better.
It could.
All right.
Thank you.
As it kind of goes down the hill, who knows how the wind is going to swirl it around.
Now, if I may familiarize myself with this, the orange line, you're staying outside that area, right?
Correct.
And what is the buffer that you're going to put between that line?
There won't be any buffer. Just the key thing is, if you look at the green circles, the green circle is the area where they overlap. The red outline is the edge of, I'll call it the safety zone, if you will.
Okay.
So if you're on the other side of the red line, you're fine. If you're inside the red line, not fine.
Yep. All right, so the buffer zone that is created is in between the red and the orange.
Yeah, correct. No.
No, inside the green.
If you're inside the orange line, there's something catastrophic, you're toast.
Right?
I mean,
the answer is just no.
That's a technical term.
The answer is, if these lights were in here, and you're inside that orange line, or you're on that orange line,
you're
right. With the concept of the gas lights and the green and the red lines, the ignition will happen at the point of those lights and go back immediately to the source.
Right.
Which then makes those orange lines go away.
The orange line sort of is still there.
The orange line is still there because that corresponds to the thermal radiation you get from that pool fire.
Right.
So when it all goes up.
So you don't want to build houses inside.
Well, it'd be an instant flash. There would be a heat flash that would destroy just about everything that around it.
Yeah, all the bigger risk is going to burn for a long time.
You're right.
That LNG has filled up the whole area and you're just getting fire for a long period of time. It's
not an explosion unless it gets in a confined culvert or sewer line or building foundation.
No, but I'm talking about the initial ignition.
Yeah.
There's a heat flash that comes from that.
That's the flash fire that will move back towards the plant.
I was in a flash fire, and this is why I'm going to reference it, is I was in a flash fire, and I was blown like 13 to 15 feet away from the initial impact of the flash. Chief, I guess, what is that movie, Backdraft, right? I mean, I don't mean to go there, but... When that explosion took place, I wasn't anywhere near the ignition zone, but the impact sent me flying just from the heat, just from the percussion of that impact. And I'll attest to it that it has a kick.
What instituted that?
Gasoline.
Yes.
Mr. Chair.
No, I was outside. I was outside, and the fumes came off of someone spilled a gas can near an open pit, a fire pit. The gas fumes floated to the fire pit, and once it hit that fire pit, and nobody knew, I thought someone had lit something and threw it at it, at the gasoline, to be funny.
Okay. Let's kind of...
Can we build on this?
Are we comfortable with... Yes, Mrs. Bessie.
I've got a couple of questions here. First of all, this new configuration is a surprise to me, because it goes through the fields that we're using for nursery crops. And I'm concerned, when I haven't talked about this, I'm concerned what effect that's going to have on our ability to farm the area there.
It won't have any effect on it. The only thing we'll be doing is putting a couple of stones around each light fixture so someone can't hit them. So it'll have no effect.
But how about plowing the field and getting...
Well, you can plow the fields as long as you don't plow the light fixtures.
Well, what are they? But they're attached to the gas line.
Yeah, they will be, but they're 3 feet underground.
Okay. That's not... I think the catastrophic thing is not my main concern, although... It may be the closest house to the facility where I live and my two kids live as well. But what does, one of the things that concerns my son-in-law, who brought this up a while back, is not a catastrophic failure, but the emission, normal emission from a plant like this, it may have other components to it that could be harmful to people downwind. We're downwind from that. And a study that he showed me that looked alarming, because they don't know exactly what the emissions would be. I just wonder, has this been studied with the...
Do you mean oxygen deprivation?
No, I mean toxic fumes of some sort that go into the atmosphere.
Question, are you talking about toxic fumes coming from the plant?
Yeah.
Does this plan change that?
No, I think
it's already... Well,
no, but it's still relevant to the safety discussion.
Yes. There should be adding more people to downwind.
Let me try to answer it, and you correct me if I'm really wrong. During this cryogenic process of cooling things down, when things get to a certain temperature, they liquefy. Methane's the last thing. And then whatever is, if there was some helium in natural gas, which there is a lot, that's where we get helium from, natural gas fields. But normally there isn't a lot. If you've got a lot of valuable helium, you get rid of it. But the helium would be left by the time you liquefied it, because the plant never gets that cold. But there are other hydrocarbons, the propanes, which would liquefy at a warmer temperature than the LNG. And a lot of that stuff gets, I think, used in the flare stack of the plant, or used as fuel to burn compressors usually and things like that. So they try to burn whatever they can. To Mr. Mezzet's point, most high-pressure gas pipes in the country, and certainly the ones that feed the gas that goes through the one that's in my backyard, are contaminated with PCBs, because there was, years ago, people used PCBs as the lubricant in the high-pressure compressors, and little bits of it got passed into the gas stream, and so if they're decommissioning a gas line, then they have to treat the pipe as hazardous waste clean it up as they go. I suspect the PCBs ends up somewhere in the plant up on the hill, probably gets burned off in the flare stack, because I'm sure they don't want to collect them, because they don't want to do something with them.
Do the sulfurs that they put in there for smell?
They odorize this before or after. The deodorants are captains. For captain compounds.
Right.
And they tend to put them in at very low, relatively low concentrations, because they stink at very low concentrations. So you're going to smell it after gas.
the gas, the odorants are in it because it's a high pressure line, like in my backyard, you know.
Is that a toxic?
I don't know. You don't smell. Yes.
Oh, wait a minute. It's arsenic. That is, there's arsenic in, is what I understand.
I haven't heard that.
I read it.
In a tiny bit. The arsenic is normally associated with particulate matter. Most of that is allowed.
Right. But I did read it because and I don't mean to digress here.
We should answer Mr. Mezzet's question.
Yes, but that's what we're trying to find out.
Somebody just needs to summarize it, though, at some point.
All right. I'll digress. I'll let it go. Go ahead.
I don't know that they have emissions that are coming off that plant. I mean,
which could only asphyxiate you. It's not going to there are some trace impurities, but you know, if the levels you encounter, then they're not going to be very harmful.
And then the only other major impurity is usually nitrogen, which you know, obviously we're breathing that
water air.
Yeah.
I didn't write any of this down, but there is a. We had some charts showing some of the emissions for plants in Texas or Oklahoma going into the atmosphere, and the trail of those was not necessarily dissipated up, but went sideways. So that's what I'd be concerned about with our families being like folks. Of course, the new families moving in there as well.
Good point. But again, it's already established, I think. You know, it's been there, and that's what it's been. And I don't know if we as board can do
Mr.
anything.
Mr. Kistner, though, we're not addressing his concern. We're addressing new people in the same situation as his. So that's
what I'm saying, Dave, is that LNG has already been there, and they're not willing at this point, at this juncture, to entertain a conversation to dispel fear or anything. So we need to find a way through our bylaws that allow us to get inside and have a discussion.
Well, the question is,
our bylaws are ruled irrelevant by the DPU and also the federal government. I mean, we have very little jurisdiction. Maybe approving some building permits, which I think we're working on that at one of them to try to get people to the table. But you know,
is there a big process to get to the federal aspect of it?
They've already won the first step, which was that DPU 1464 that we gave you some of the stuff.
Yep.
And to get to be an intervener to be able to talk in that discussion, it is. It's a hearing in public, not a public hearing.
Okay.
I mean, it's...
I think at the end, we're getting off topic because we can't control what Eversource is doing. And we can only control what Mr. McDowell's trying to do. And this plan is basically, as I see it, the last line of defense. It's
And you've done a wonderful job.
I don't know if there's a plan better to protect...
I move for a vote. Does this plan make it safe?
Sure.
It does.
A second.
Just a second. I'm going to give you guys an option. Yep. We've got all of us here tonight, which is good. We've been continuing these special permits to go along, primarily waiting on this plan. We haven't yet opened up the special permit. I'm willing to open up the special permit, which would be the master plan special permit for Pulte Homes, which adjusts the master building permit buildable area, and because I think we're pretty comfortable with the overall north development where it is. I mean, the engineers are all working on where it is.
Yep.
So I think we know what the buildable land is per se at this point, and we also know that all of that buildable land is outside the safety area. So we can open that up, because that's going to take us about 5 or 6 minutes, which will kind of close it out, and then that's a big step.
Sure.
And I think we can productively get that done better than going through construction management plan today, because
we're working on other things, yeah.
So we're talking about doing the big vote, right?
This would be a change to the master plan special permit.
So follow-up is, the only open item that I had was the curbs on the roads, and I'm okay.
That's still site plan.
Okay.
So that, no, we're talking about that. This is just the change to the master plan special permit.
Ask about yes or no.
For a letter. So
okay.
I think we come to the conclusion that we're going to open it up to public hearing for the master plan special permit for Pulte Homes in New England. This is for adjustment to the master plan buildable area. And I think we have that plan somewhere that we're going to talk to.
If I may, through the chair, I'm not comfortable changing the order of the discussion. And it's that time of the night. I don't see us ending in 5 minutes.
We're all talked about what we need to talk about.
And even the new guys, Frank, are pretty much abreast to what's going on here.
Just to be clear, Mr. Chairman, this is Legacy North and not the 180 units.
That's correct. Right. That is absolutely correct. And Jennifer, you had put together 3 conditions, I believe.
Yes, 2 are in your memo, and 4, which is a paragraph about the required vote. And the third one, the bill of that the Homeowners Association will continue to maintain and upgrade the gas light.
So basically, the vote would be the MMF special permit, available there, to a certain plan, which I believe we have.
That would be in our packet as well.
What discussion of the gas lights to the?
Yes, sir. We are. Yes, we are. Absolutely.
Do you have an objection to that?
It's not that I have an objection. I just caught up. I was surprised.
Yeah. That's only surprise?
Yeah, I'm up to speed on the discussion that the board had, Mark Mastriani, for the record, both young, on the gas discussion, and that was very fruitful. And our company has no concerns or issues with the discussion that the board and Roy McDowell presented. And you were up to speed on the buildable area change, the special permit amendment for the buildable area change to reflect the latest and greatest site plan that we've been working on over all these months. I just didn't know the two were connected in any way.
Well, to Frank's
point, no. Let me answer the question, because we are getting close. One of Roy's agreements with Eversource basically says that if the planning board requires it in the master plan special permit, then they got a lot to do it, because they already have a restriction on this land. That's why I want to tie it to that particular piece. And that's the piece that keeps them out of the loop and makes it happen.
Could you explain that? Because I thought it had a map with the buildable lots, and it made sense, and had the red lines and the green lines, and I can't find that now.
Is this what you're looking for?
I think
it means
an older one.
Could someone want to send that down?
An older one? Or?
Yeah, I was looking online. This is what we're talking about right now, then.
Correct.
Yes.
Okay.
And this is the continued public hearing for Northwest, blah, blah, blah. Not the application to amend Legacy Farm Master Plan.
Correct.
Well,
this is for the Master Plan Special Permit. Entertain a motion to approve the changes in master plan buildable things, referencing that plan that we just were holding up, with the 3 conditions that Jennifer just talked about: the LNG mitigation proposal for gas lamps is outlined in the letter by Mosaic. It's shown on the plan, which will be slightly modified. It'll be installed and operational prior to the first occupancy permit on the north side of Legacy Farms. No development will take place in exclusion areas on the mitigation plan as attached, and in three, the home association will continue to operate these.
Mr. Chairman,
yeah.
Could you possibly change that homeowner association to the landowners association?
Absolutely, landowners.
It's really the landowners.
Got it.
The homeowners.
Okay.
Thank you.
Well, here's where I'm comfortable changing the order of what's on the agenda. Is that I'm very comfortable finishing and voting on the northeast, northwest, and North Club villages. And that's why I thought the gas discussion was about, because they're on the perimeter, but the main part of the gas discussion is about
the land
which we're talking about now.
You have zoning up here. The next thing to do is have the master plan special permit. So from an order standpoint, we have to make this motion first before we would end up getting to the site plan approval.
We've discussed this before, and they're completely different things, is what my understanding.
Trust me, this is the order you have to do it.
It sounds right to me, but Frank, I'm entertaining your...
The last sentence in the paragraph. Not the 180.
Okay.
We're not doing the 180.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Is not in
then I made
in
that
discussion.
Comment, not the 180.
Correct.
Thank you.
Are you looking for a motion?
Yes.
So, second.
Move to second.
Awarded more.
Further discussion.
For clarification, this is the one part of the motion that comes before the rest. All of the
yes.
Northeast, Northwest, North Block.
There will still be two pieces left.
Thank you.
Okay. I think you're ready for a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay. I think we've done all the tough work for the town tonight. And, well, we've got a couple other minor things. But
so LNG is behind us, right?
LNG is, yes. Okay. So I would like to take a motion to continue the site plan review to August.
Can you just close that hearing before you...
Oh, okay. The motion to close the public hearing on the special permit for the adjustment to the master plan buildable area.
So moved.
Moved and seconded.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? All those in favor or abstain, motion carries. Okay. Move to continue the public hearing for the Northwest, Northeast, North Club villages at Legacy Farms. This is the site plan review to August 8th at 9 p.m.
So moved.
Second.
Move seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Abstain, motion carries. Last motion is to continue the public hearing for the application to amend the Legacy Farms Master and Special Permit for the 188 units. Why do you want to do that on the 9th or the 22nd? You want to put all your time and effort on getting the... Yeah.
Much prefer that.
Okay. August 22nd at 7:30 p.m.
So moved.
Okay.
Moved and seconded. All those ready for a vote. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Thank you very much. We, board members, we still have minutes to approve and a couple other letters.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
Entertain a motion. Well, we'll now discuss May 9th, 2016 minutes. Any comments, questions? If not, entertain Motion to approve as written.
So moved.
Second. Seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Minutes for the May 23rd, 2016. Any discussion? Any changes? Seeing none. Look for a motion to approve.
So moved.
Second. Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay. You might have noticed, I'd like to send a letter to the zoning enforcement officer regarding screening at the HCA. We have a requirement to do screening.
In the front.
In the front. Yep. And the bushes are about this big.
Yeah, I don't think
that's crap.
And it was obviously didn't do anywhere near the intent we were thinking. So formally, we'd like to request that the zoning enforcement officer will vote to authorize the chairman to send such a letter.
Discuss.
To ask them to review that and enforce it.
There was also supposed to be some screening around the electrical box.
We'll include that.
To the north of that.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah, and also to bring up to that point, the sound, there was a resident talking about the noise that emanates from the air conditioners on your last meeting. I watched
that was the high school
that was he referenced the high school, but he also said that on the roofs of this new building that they're putting the air conditioner up, that he had concerns over that.
Okay, well, let's just go to the ones that we can really enforce. So I'm looking for a motion to send a letter about landscaping and screening.
Second.
Discussion. Is the only matter of recourse we have at this point is to send a letter?
It's the zoning enforcement officer that has to enforce it at this point. We, as a board, do not have
jurisdiction.
We're not the enforcer. Once we give the decision, it goes off to somebody else to enforce it. We got the promises that there was going to be
I remember.
And I reached out several times over the last couple months and have not got any response, so.
From zoning?
No.
Oh.
Was that Chuck? Is that Chuck?
Zoning enforcement.
And the second letter I'd like to send to the zoning enforcement letter regards the wall sign on.
It's fixed.
Did it get fixed?
Did it fix?
No.
Did I send you an email?
No.
Oh, it's fixed.
Yeah,
Davenport.
It got fixed. Good.
It's not
at all.
Yeah.
Not pretty at all, but it got fixed.
Yeah, I saw that.
Really?
Okay, never mind.
Take a drive.
I think you just pencil on the wall.
What did they do?
I think they did etch it. It's black. It's going to be
black. It's not very attractive.
It's not very attractive.
Whatever.
Why would they want something ugly?
Was that also a talk?
Yeah. Okay.
Oh, very good. Two for two.
Yeah.
Are we voting?
No speakable content to be found on the screen.
Okay.
Any other things that people want to bring up? Agenda items?
Jen, you were supposed to draft that letter to the DPW about the sidewalks? Or that's coming up?
Yeah, I have not.
Okay. What, you busy or something?
No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah, I have a question. I got into it a little with Eric Sonnet. He's telling me 2,500 people are going to be coming out of the parking lot and crossing Hayden Rowe at the EMC Park on a Saturday.
Are you talking about the trail and come out?
Yeah, the trail. Because I say hello to Chamberlain, and he said, "Well, you can't put a trail on Chamberlain. Chamberlain's a dead end. I live on Chamberlain."
Yeah. I think they have big dreams about who's going to use the sidewalk on weekends.
So, but what's to stop the people from coming out of EMC? Now, you're talking about a light front of that gentleman's house. Now you're talking another light 50 feet away at EMC Park, or else how are you going to cross the street there?
I
didn't get into it with him.
I wanted to ask him again because I've asked him for a master
plan. That number at me.
No, for a master plan of where the trails are, where the rough schedules of their trails, where they're going to be.
What's that going to do with the traffic?
About going to one of the trails meetings and asking
a
question. Yeah.
That's a good idea.
I wonder what he's based that on.
It's grandiose.
All those in favor of adjourning, say aye.
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 Yeah. I just, well, it's the same thing with the...